The entire American identity was born on the idea of unshackling ourselves from centralized, aristocratic, monarchical exercise of power over the everyday citizen to say that the person who's in charge reports to me rather than the other way around. So when we start behaving the other way, the whole identity is gone.
There are Bitcoiners, very well-known, prominent Bitcoiners, who actually would argue for a return to a monarchy over democracy. They would say democracy has failed. Probably for similar reasons that you're pointing out, that managerial class.
I understand that argument. I do.
The reason they prefer a monarchy is that
democracy can create a mob, right?
Yeah. So. Whereas, like, you've essentially got an individual who has to keep the country happy, and if they don't, you have a revolution.
That's right. So I get that, and I'm deeply sold. But it sort of gets it. So all I would say is, when I'm using the word democracy, now let's get one more level specific, which is I'm using it. There's two senses of democracy.
Yeah.
Actually, America was born not as a democracy, but as a constitutional republic. And yes, I've been trying as much as I can to use that term here, but it's a little bit of a mouthful. But there's a big distinction. So I think that America was purposefully not born in the image of a direct democracy, because direct democracy can lead to the tyranny of the same form that I'm using shorthand monarchy for. And you can actually have a version of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy that actually looks very different than...
No, I understand. I get corrected on this all the time.
But broadly speaking, I think we get each other and what we're saying.
When I say democracy, I mean the ability to vote.
Yeah. The ability to have, exactly, a stake in determining who the leaders of the country really are. Now, I'm a...
Maybe you should just try a king. See how you get on. See what happens.
It wouldn't be America itself. It might be something else, but it's not going to be America. In Britain, it can still be Britain. Here, it just wouldn't be America, right? It'd be something else.
It'd be
something totally different. But that's why it strikes a different valence here than it does over there, is that the whole dang thing. And so what's the solution? You're asking earlier. I think it is a revival of shared American identity at a moment where we lack one. And I think that could go a long way from a different angle too, right? Speaking from my millennial seat again. Like, our generation is very hungry for a cause, for purpose, for identity. We just hunger for these things. We suffer from widespread depression and anxiety and insecurity and loneliness. We flock to secular religions like wokeism or transgenderism or climatism or COVIDism or whatever it is, because we're hungry for a deeper purpose, and we serially hunt from one to the next, not knowing what we're even searching for. And I personally think part of what we hunger for is a nation, is that nation. And a revival of that nation, built around the unapologetic pursuit of excellence, that's how I frame it. That was what my second book was all about. But maybe somebody else can frame it differently. But reviving that national identity and filling that hole, that vacuum, should be our calling. I think it should be the calling of the GOP, because the GOP is itself as a party in search of an identity, so it might as well be this. But I think if we can fill that generational hunger for purpose and meaning and identity and move beyond this mistaken decade of celebrating our diversity, I think we've become very smitten with that over the last decade. I think our diversity is completely meaningless if there's nothing greater that binds us together across that diversity, or else we're nothing more than this group of different looking higher mammals roaming a common geographic terrain, doing what our smartphone told us to do on a given day. That's not the American idea, right? American idea is that there's a set of ideals that bind us together across our different demographic and genetic attributes. Reviving that, both through the market, and that's a big part of why I founded Strive, is I think Strive can serve as a unifying force in capital markets, in the economy, in corporate America, through the message that we deliver to focus on excellence over politics. And I can, you know, tell you all about that, but that's I think part of those solutions can come through the market. But I think part of it can come through, and ought to come through, our politics as well, possibly through the revival of a new conservative movement, and it doesn't have to be a conservative movement, a new pro-American movement, whose goal is to fill that missing vacuum of American identity. And I think there's an opportunity to do that, and hopefully the next 24 months are all about that with the season that we have coming up in this country.
What if you're wrong, Vivek? So what if there is a... what if this push and pull at the moment is a part that's pulling back towards traditional historic American values that were built out of the Constitution, or 1776. And what if the other side is a pull towards more kind of, how would I put it, European kind of ideals and values?
It's because, great framing, actually.
And the reason I ask this, because, I'm sure, Danny, we saw a poll once where it was like, America's pretty much kind of 50-50. Let's say 50-50, Republican, Democratic. I know it's not exactly, but just for the sake of this. But if the world was to vote, whether they're Republican, Democratic, it was largely swayed towards the Democratic side. I cannot remember where I saw this. Like, if you suddenly imported 70 million British people into America and they were voting, it wouldn't be a 50-50. It wouldn't even be close. The majority would be voting Democrat. Because even on, this is why I made that joke to you at the very start. I'm a center-right in the UK, and the people here think I'm a woke liberal. Mm-hmm. Because we're less extreme, but we're very different. But perhaps there is this kind of old world, traditional American values, which feels very Republican, and there's this new world, rest of the world values, which is being pulled towards.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I've articulated it well.
I think you're absolutely describing the struggle in the United States right now is pull towards 1776, pull towards traditional European model. That's what's at issue. That's exactly it.
I see, by the way, this...
That's exactly it. That was the push and pull at the American Revolution. It was fought through
you
a
want
war.
Us, you want us back?
Well, I don't, but
we've got a king. We can bring him back.
Yeah, I don't want that. But other people seem to, and that it's not a Republican Democrat thing quite. But there's correlation. So I grant you that. But that is the struggle, and I am in the camp of saying I don't want America to go in the direction of just becoming another nation in what otherwise is the normal arc of human history, which raises this question of a word that you hear bandied about from time to time: American exceptionalism. What does that mean? Refers to the way in which America is an exception to that general rule of certainly, you know, Western and probably global human social societal structuring. American exceptionalism refers to the fact that we take exception to that. I believe in that. And so this is just a local question where maybe you have a more, maybe even more, a higher perch than I do, because I'm mired in this parochially nationalistic framing of the discussion because I'm American and that happens to be the thing I care about. You're right. If you zoom out and looked at this from like Mars, and then we're analyzing this, you know, unique region across time and space, you're right. There's this just tug of war between, for the soul of a nation. Is it the 1776 version, or is it the, you know, the 16th century version, or the 17th century version that is more representative of what existed for a lot longer of time in the cultural predecessor, even the linguistic predecessor of the United States? Just so happens that I'm in one of those camps.
But the interesting thing is, where I've told you where I probably sit on the political spectrum, I want your version to maintain. And the reason I want your version to maintain is I romanticize about the history of America and American values. I've come to not be a huge fan of globalization. And I think there may be I think I've got the first one of my shows you should listen to. So
I'll take a look.
We made a you know which one I'm going to say, Gladstein. I made a show with a guy called Alex Gladstein from the Human Rights Foundation. He did a study into the role of the IMF and the World Bank.
Can I write that down?
Oh, no, we'll send you a link. Danny will find it for you. We'll send you that. He's wrote a paper and we made a podcast about it. And historically, the Europeans left an imperialist imprint on the world as they sailed the seas and conquered nations and essentially stole resources. The American version of that has essentially been an economic imperialism, whereby the use of things such as the World Bank and the IMF have essentially forced or changed countries. The great example he gave, was it Bangladesh?
Yeah.
He said, just as an example, go to Bangladesh, lend them lots of money, they get into debt, And the IMF and the World Bank, historically, they've tended to go to nations where it's easy to kind of give people money or take it. This is your managerial class, by the way. Mm-hmm. And some of Bangladesh, what they would get them to do is to farm shrimp. This is economically successful. You can farm lots of shrimp, you can sell it around the world. But the problem is the shrimp isn't being sold back into the Bangladeshis. And so what's tended to happen, these nations have become dependent on the dollar, they've become dependent on debt, and this has allowed America and, you know, other European nations to maintain their rich, successful expense. The lifestyles we get to live are based on the resources being extracted from the developing world or poorer nations. Mm-hmm. That is your managerial class that's created that. And that part of, there might be a connection there for, in with the story you're trying to tell in why this has happened. You know, it might come internally from
very interesting. Yeah.
So I think you would really enjoy that.
I think I would too.
Yeah. And I think that might be the connection that's caused this. So I think for America to be able to return to its traditional values, I think it has to return to its history of building its own economic success within its own boundaries, with its own manufacturing. You know, something it's got away from.
Mm-hmm. You know, I get to the same conclusion increasingly, but for a slightly different reason. It changes the topic a little bit, but it actually is an interesting bridge to go there, because there's much more to say about what you just brought up. But anyway, I actually get there from a national security perspective. I actually think that the necessity of defeating China, both economically and militarily, or I should more precisely say economically so that we don't have to militarily, which I think is the far preferable way for this to play out, leads to that same place, not out of some sort of economically protectionist or even culturally protectionist motivation, but just out of a national security existential vantage point. And, you know, I think an interesting thing about this, you know, defeating China question is the major difference that the U.S. faces right now. It's a challenge. I think this is one of the complex challenges of public policymaking in the United States, of foreign policy right now in this unique moment we live in, is unlike the Cold War of the 20th century, where the U.S. defeated a mighty rival in the USSR, we never relied on the USSR to provide the shoes on our feet and the phones in our pockets. And I think today, we do rely on our arch rival, dare I say enemy, for providing the shoes on our feet and the phones in our pockets.
But that is a bilateral relationship. They rely on you.
Yeah, but one was far ahead of the other and used that to be able to make itself appear from a vantage point where it began nowhere near that pier.
Of course, yeah.
At the time of the fall of the Soviet Union. Yeah, so that was exactly... That's already a win for China, right? Now it's to potentially even surpass and be in a position of greater global authority. But, you know, I think the first stop Xi Jinping wants to get to is to an unambiguously non-unipolar but bipolar global order, right? And so that's destination number one. Destination number two will be to recreate a unipolar world in which China is the center of gravity of that unipolar world rather than the United States. But I am... perhaps optimistically from a U.S. standpoint, not yet conceding that we are yet at a stable equilibrium of a bipolar world order, but in China's march, the seemingly inexorable march towards that new stable equilibrium, part of what got them there was kind of like Greece with Troy, delivering a Trojan horse that they knew we could not resist, which was the Trojan horse of capitalism itself, global capitalism in air quotes. Capitalism in air quotes, because they were really pulling mercantilist strings from behind the scenes, but it deluding us into thinking that it was capitalism, much as, you know, Greece deluded Troy into thinking that it actually was just a beautiful Trojan horse, when in fact there were a lot of other agendas at work that, you know, did their work once global capitalism had become the vector for delivering it. So I think, anyway, the complicated challenge for the United States right now is how do we defeat an enemy that we depend on to power our modern way of life? And I think that the short answer is that's going to, if we're going to do it, involve the pain of ripping off a Band-Aid, of incurring some short-term economic cost in order to protect ourselves against existential long-run risk. I mean, I think semiconductor self-reliance is a big part of that. That's going to take a long time to get there. I mean, those are the chips that power the phones, the laptops we use, that power the cameras that are recording this conversation. Leading-edge semiconductors come from Taiwan. We're going to have to protect Taiwan from invasion until we build up our semiconductor production capabilities here in the United States. It is shameful that we got this far to have relied on a random island in the middle of the South China Sea to power our entire modern way of life. For the refrigerator that kept this can of water cold before you kindly brought it out for me here is probably powered. I'm looking at it right now. I can tell it's the kind of refrigerator. Probably powered by an advanced semiconductor. Those aren't made here. Those are made in Taiwan. But anyway, my reason why I bring that up is I think it's just as a national security matter, it's table stakes for us getting there to be able to make more of those things here. And then I'm a little less so than like many of my friends on the populist right, you know, the Josh Hawley, you know, J.D. Vance kind of crowd, you know, who would also just believe we need to do that for sense of American pride and economic, you know, protection of workers. I don't begrudge those benefits, but I think the main motivation for me to support those same policies is just our national security agenda vis-a-vis China. But all to say that these things aren't necessarily separable from one another. They go hand in hand together. And there, I think you have, you know, two prongs of a policy agenda that can lead to that national. Actually, we've talked about three of them. We talked about restoring free speech. We talked about dismantling the managerial class. We talked about defeating China economically so that we don't have to militarily. And I could go on for hours about that, including my views on what that means for energy policy in this country. And then the fourth element that I would just add to that list, and then we've covered a lot of policy bases, is embracing merit in this country. It's actually an important value of our national identity, an important competitive advantage, even vis-a-vis China and other countries that we've lost in this country, embracing merit over identity politics, eviscerating affirmative action in every sphere of American life, restoring the idea that you advance in this country based not on the color of your skin, but on the content of your character and contributions. To me, we're 80% of the way there on an American revival, on a revival of that national identity that we're missing, actualizing it through policy in ways that change people's lives. If I was to give it to you in order, probably defeat China, dismantle the managerial class, restore free speech, and embrace merit over identity politics, I think we're in pretty good shape. So I'm an optimist that this can be done.